What's up, guys? Welcome to Daily Dose of Reddit. This is your host, Zach, and today's subreddit is r/ProRevenge. Alright, this story's called, Want to make a Girl Scout trip awful for a few of my friends? I'll help them get you banned! This isn't quite my revenge story, but I did play a part in it. It's also going to be a long one. So I was in Girl Scouts for almost 10 years, and from September 2005 to October 2006, I had this awful Girl Scout leader who clearly didn't like me very much. I didn't fit her. Everyone in my troop needs to have a type A personality mentality. And she did a lot of really awful stuff to me. She knew I was terrified of dogs. I was attacked by two dogs in a public park as a young child and highly allergic, and didn't inform me that a search and rescue dog would be visiting our troop. Then use me as the target for a demonstration, causing me to nearly pass out due to the combination of the panic and allergy attacks I had. The handler refused to sign the paperwork for the badge activity, and instead of picking another activity to complete the badge, the leader decided we would earn the badge and blamed me. She canceled a community cookie sale I was scheduled to run with another girl and her mother because I had to duck out at the last minute because I got sick, and blamed me. She put me in charge of a magazine subscription fundraiser I told her I wouldn't be able to run because of academic commitments. It inevitably failed, and she not only blamed me, but kicked me out of her troop. I joined another troop, and the leader turned her desire for a scapegoat to another two girls on my troop, one of whom I went to school with. This will be important later. Now, in April of 2007, that troop took a Girl Scout sponsored and funded trip to London during school vacation week that the council in our area put a significant amount of money into. And I feel like I need to explain because it's relevant to the story. Girl Scouts is very strict when it comes to lodging accommodations for overnight trips, camping or otherwise. Under no circumstances may girls stay in the same room or building for camping trips as an adult male. I was in a troop where one of our assistant leaders was a troop member's father. When we went on weekend camping trips, he had to sleep in a tent outside the lodge we stayed in, and when the troop went to Savannah, Georgia, he wasn't allowed to stay in the same room as his own daughter. Well, this awful troop leader decided to save some money by staying in co-ed adult hostels while in London, but told the Girl Scout Council that they would be staying in hotels. None of the girls or parents of the girls were remotely okay with this decision, but the leader basically told them,
I'm the leader. We do what I say, and if anyone says anything, I'll make sure you get kicked out of the organization.
I don't exactly know what happened on the trip because, well, I had already been kicked out of that troop, but from what I heard from the girl I went to school with, their lodging accommodations were terrifying, and most of the girls found themselves too scared to sleep. One night, a guy was strutting around the hostel in his birthday suit and would make lewd comments to the girls who were between the ages of 12 and 15. One night, one of the girls woke up to another guy just staring at her while she slept, and the leader didn't see anything wrong with it.
What the hell?
She just brushed it off, saying,
well, that will sometimes happen when you stay at hostels.
The two girls, and everyone else on the troop, wanted to get back at her, but all of them were intimidated by her. So I casually mentioned to my school friend that my troop leader was on the Girl Scout Council, and if her and other girl were willing to visit my troop for a meeting, we could potentially work something out. The other girl said she would provide the pictures she had secretly taken in the hostels. The girls were warned not to take pictures in the hostels, but didn't want to be involved any further than that. My school friend was moving to another state during summer break, decided she had nothing to lose, and came to my troop meeting with her laptop and flash drive with a copy of the pictures on it from the other another girl. My leader was appalled and immediately asked if she could borrow the flash drive so she could present it at the end of the year council meeting. She also promised she would keep our identities a secret. Again, I don't quite know what happened at that council meeting since it was held during school hours, but from what my leader told me, all heck broke loose, and here's the aftermath. The awful leader was immediately kicked out of the organization and given a lifetime ban. She was stripped of all the multiple awards she had earned as an adult. She was forced to pay the $2,000 the council had awarded her for the trip, on top of the $10,000+ fine she was handed. Girl Scouts take the safety of their members very seriously. She was nearly charged for child endangerment, but none of the parents of the girls involved wanted to go that far. I still see that leader at the market I work at from time to time, and usually say hi and ask how things are going without knowing that I had a hand in getting her banned from Girl Scouts. Okay, what the hell? Is that just a thing that happens? What? Like, I get it. There's a reason why that's the reason why they don't want the kids to sleep in the same room as an adult male, because this crap happens. But like, the one time they do that we are aware of, this crap happens? What? Why are dudes so nasty? Oh my god, those poor kids. They just kind of gloss over it here, but that is traumatizing. But thank god the stupid ass whatchamacallit, what are they called? What's she called? Scout leader got booted because boo. This story's called Steal My iPod, Screw Your Laptop, a story from 2007. I posted this on Petty Revenge, but after thinking about it, it actually may be better suited her. Imagine being in high school, back in the latter days of George Bush, and finally buying that iPod of your dreams. After saving up your allowance and the money you made around the neighborhood doing random ass work and lifeguarding at the local pool. Yep, that was me. And I was that douchebag 14-year-old who would make sure you knew I had one of the better iPods. One that could play video. It was the latest Nano, if I remember right. Simpler times. But every story needs an antagonist. My sister happened to find that role many times. We are very close now, but back then, it wasn't so rosy. She was a teenager as well, and spent most of those years resenting me. If I had something nice, screw you for having that. I was quite protective of my precious iPod. She raised quite the dookie tornado when my parents refused to buy her one.
Your brother saved his money. We didn't pay for it.
We are not stopping you from buying one too if you save your money.
That was their attitude toward any luxury that us kids wanted. Even up to that time when buying a first car was on the table, we each had to buy our own. It built character and taught responsibility. Well, that iPod goes missing one day at home when I knew damn well I had left it charging at the family computer. I left it unattended. My parents confirmed they did not touch it, and all eyes were on my sister. I'll jump ahead here. As it turned out, she had indeed taken it and had one of her friends temporarily store it until the heat was off of her. She knew my parents would essentially strip search her. After this unraveled, one of my buddies saw her with the iPod at school several days later, it was time for payback. Back then, I liked to think of myself as a bona fide hacker. That's right, I knew all about batch files and how to open command prompt. Don't frickin' cross me. You have no idea what I'm capable of. Yeah, anyway, we don't talk about those dark days. But I actually did know enough to copy-paste some destructive commands into scripts using delete and reg delete commands and the like. In the days of Windows XP, this would essentially require reinstalling the OS. I also was aware of a program called Bat2X, which could package your batch files and associated files it would call from the same directory into a normal .exe file, and you could pick an icon to slap on that .exe file if you had the ICO file on hand. It doesn't take a genius, because as much as I thought I was one.
I wasn't. To devise a plan here.
I put a script together with the worst crap I could muster and gave it the Internet Explorer icon. This went onto my sister's computer, which was an old Pentium M laptop which barely had enough ass to load MySpace at the time. My hacker abilities allowed me to log into the administrator account by booting into safe mode or something and simply replacing the Internet Explorer.exe main file with my science experiment. I believe I had it to where it actually opened the real Internet Explorer in parallel, so I could deny this more easily. Fast forward to that magical moment. She's home from color guard practice and is ready for an evening full of crappy webcam photos that use every mid-2000s effect ever created. But before she can upload them, disaster! The screen resolution goes tits up, and the color profile is 16 colors for some reason. Random pop-up messages every few seconds. Microsoft Windows has detected a giant cooter! Please consider a system upgrade! And stuff like that.
Your hard drive is jammed with peanut butter! Restart required!
The whole script plays out, and she's left with a paperweight until someone can get around to sorting it. Unfortunately, the computer guy in the family took quite a while to get around to it. My dad knew damn well that I had something to do with this, even if he didn't understand it fully. He made my sister apologize to me before I helped her with the laptop and made her buy me a new case for it, after she threw away the one I had to try and make it less identifiable. Well, that's a story, folks. I have a video from 8+ years ago of this script running in a virtual machine if anyone wants to see it. Hope 2021 is off to a decent start for you. Feeling supersonic. Here's a video I made this after submitting this to ProRevenge in 2013. I forgot completely I had done that back then. My old account got banned in 2013 because I told someone on crap Reddit says to grow up or something. This version used the Chrome icon, and I remember tweaking it a little so it would execute most of the payload on reboot. I had uploaded it at one point after some people requested a copy. I can try to find it, but I am almost certain it was on the external hard drive that died after I dropped it years ago. Edit 2! To people asking what happened to the iPod, I got it back after learning from my buddy that she was going to have it on her. She was in a world of crap from my very traditional discipline that child parents, in addition to her laptop being a boat anchor for a few weeks. Very freaking solid revenge, my friend. Plus, I enjoyed how you wrote that story. It was a fun time to read. But yeah, that's crappy of your sister, man. Glad she's not as mean nowadays. She's grown up. I'm curious, who's older though? Alright, this story's called Guy Parks in My Parking Space, So I Block Him In for About 3 Hours. On mobile, so please be kind. So let me lay the scene out for you. This happened about a year back, late in the evening. I was hanging out at my cousin's place, and I had to head home to feed my dogs. Let me explain our parking since I had taken the car out. There's a property next to our house that belongs to my father's brother. There's nothing constructed on it, but there's like 5 truckloads of dirt and mud with enough space by the road for a couple of cars. That is where we always park both our vehicles. So as I reach home, I see an unknown vehicle parked in my space, and I was visibly annoyed because this happens every time. Either someone parks in our space or double parks and blocks us in. So I decided to serve some petty revenge. I carefully park my car in such a way that I was blocking him in and at the same time not blocking him. There was enough space that if he wiggled his car back and forth enough, he'd be able to get out without damaging any vehicles parked there. After that was done, I headed home, served the dogs, and headed for a shower. Now, I take long showers, and I had to dress up because I was heading back to my cousin's place, so it was about 2.5 hours after I was done with everything. I head back down and get on my bike ready to leave when I see someone trying to flag me down. I head over to see a guy guy, maybe in his late 20s, asking if that's my car. I ask him which one, the one that's blocked or the one doing the blocking. He gets annoyed and points to my car, to which I confirm that it is my car. He demands that I move it immediately as he was getting late for something. I don't remember what. I then asked him whether this was his property and if he was allowed to park there. He said that he knew the people who stayed in that house and that they gave him permission to park there. The idiot was pointing at my house, and I know for a fact that nobody gave him permission to park there. I had the biggest crap-eating grin in my face. On my face, when I told him that the house he was pointing at was my house, this was my property, and he didn't have any permission to park there. His face lost all expression, and he was visibly flustered. He then continued to demand that I move my vehicle so that he could leave. I just told him that he should have thought about that before parking on private property. I then got on my bike and left. His face looked like as if someone told him no for the first time. It was priceless. I returned home a few hours later to find that he and his car were gone. I went to check if he had damaged my car, but he surprisingly left without any damages on the car. People can be so entitled sometimes. Oh man, it must have felt good having that power over that dude. Ownership of a parking space can do a lot to a person. He must be stopped. Alright, this story's called, I Got Even with a Bully Boy Scout During a Holiday Gift Exchange. When I was 12 years old, my Boy Scout troop was full of people that didn't like me. I went to a different school than them, and I was a nerd. There was one particular bully that really treated me badly. We were having a gift exchange near Christmas, and we were all supposed to each bring a wrapped gift that equaled $10 and place them on a table for each person to choose one at a time. Before preparing my gift, I had the bully in mind. I found two of the same exact crappy magazines, 90% full of ads, that were free that I picked up when leaving a drugstore. The beauty of it, each magazine said $4.99 on it, even though they were complimentary. Long story short, the bully ended up picking the invitingly wrapped crappy magazines that I wrapped, and oh boy, was he in tears when he opened them. Ha! Deserves it. Bullies suck. That's right, guys. Call me a hero, but I am against bullying. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode.